Blackstone Audiobooks presents Bobbed Hair and Bathtub Gin, Writers Running Wild in the 20s. Zelda Fitzgerald, Edna St. Vincent Millay, Dorothy Parker, and Edna Ferber. By Marion Meade. Read by Lorna Raver. Chapter 1, 1920. It couldn't be worse. 26, and she was losing her job. Vanity Fair's editor-in-chief broke the news in the grandeur of the tea court at the Plaza Hotel, beneath the Tiffany glass dome, amid the cayenne stone and the brush violet marble, the baccarat crystal and gold-encrusted china, the hand-woven Savonnery rugs. He had to fire her, Frank Cronenshield said, because his former theater critic was planning to return to the magazine, and of course he needed his old job back. She said she didn't know that. He hoped she would work at home and do little pieces in her spare time. She said she really couldn't. She had no idea how to change a typewriter ribbon. Vanity Fair had no cause to fire her, thought Dorothy Parker. And so what if every producer on Broadway hated her? It was Sunday afternoon on Central Park South. The carriage horses dozed standing up at the curbs. The leafless trees across the street were dark against the dusky sky. When Dottie emerged from the hotel, she went straight home, round Columbus Circle, up Broadway, back to the Upper West Side, where she grew up. From an early age, she knew a thing or two about misfortune. A dead mother, E. coli, a dead stepmother, stroke, and a brother who vanished without a trace. Amnesia, homicide, possibly pique. And not only them, but her uncle, Martin Rothschild, a first-class passenger on the unsinkable Titanic. Martin, the family martyr. Sometimes it seemed as if her whole life had been spent waiting for something terrible to happen. Even so, to be canned over tea and scones with the accompaniment of harp and violin was the absolutely worst. She had spent 4 years with the Condé Nast Publishing Company, her first and only real job. Her husband was waiting when she walked into the apartment. Edwin Pond Parker II, scion of congregational clergymen and once a Wall Street broker, had served during the war in the muddy trenches of France as an ambulance driver. His van hurtled into a bomb crater, and Eddie spent 2 days buried with the dead and the wounded before being rescued. Handsome, blonde, a Connecticut thoroughbred, he had appeared to be an ideal husband before the war. Since the armistice, he'd been devoting himself almost full-time to alcohol and morphine. Not surprisingly, Eddie had little practical advice to offer, and so for counsel and comfort she turned to her best friend. Robert Benchley was the managing editor of Vanity Fair, and while everybody called him Bob or Rob, she never did. With her impeccable manners, she addressed him ladylike as Mr. Benchley, or Fred, or in times of very bad trouble, dear Fred. And he in return called her Mrs. Parker. The day he walked into the office for the first time, Dottie knew that she and Bob Benchley were kindred spirits, sharing a similar sense of humor. For example, he subscribed to The Casket, an undertaker's magazine that published everything you always wanted to know about subjects such as embalming. Sometimes, in the fresh body of a robust suicide, the descending colon may be contracted to the thickness of the thumb. Dottie had never known anyone who thought it necessary to be well informed about embalming. Immediately, she ordered her own subscription. Each month, she leafed through the casket ads for hearses and giggled over the humor column, from grave to gay. Then she clipped the most interesting anatomic plates to hang above her desk. Over the months, her office friendship with Mr. Benchley had deepened steadily and platonically, despite gossip to the contrary, until now they were practically inseparable. In the early evening of January the 11th, Bob left his home in Scarsdale and hurried into town on the 7 o'clock train. It was easy to see that Crowney shared none of the responsibility for dismissing Dottie, since he was little more than a hired hand in the Condé Nast empire, Vanity Fair, Vogue, House and Garden. The man behind her firing was Nast himself. Recently he had denied her a raise and squawked about several pieces, but she'd never given it a second thought. By every reasonable standard, she had done nothing wrong. Unfortunately, the publisher had never figured out that the duty of a critic was to determine what is of high artistic quality and what isn't. After several hours spent loudly damning Nast for stupidity, the men ought to be horsewhipped at the least. Both of them fell back on personal principles. She knew everything bad happened to her. He always believed the greatest sin was disloyalty.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.